I'm Georgios Provatas. I work at the Laboratory for Ion Beam Interactions, which is at the Ruđer Bošković Institute in Zagreb, Croatia, and belongs to the Division of Experimental Physics. Here in our laboratory, I don't know if you heard in the previous lectures, we have two accelerators. It's 1 megavolt tandetron accelerator and one van de Graaff accelerator that can reach up to 6 megavolts. These two accelerators are equipped with two sputtering sources, also an alphatros that is plugged at the van de Graaff accelerator and a plasmatron at the tandetron accelerator. And with these sources, we can accelerate almost all elements of the periodic table. In our laboratory, we have 8 end stations. Two of them that are highlighted here are devoted to microprobe setups. We have our old microprobe on the right that it is already more than 15 years experience in conducting measurements with microbeams. And also the new microprobe is being under development. It is under development. So starting from very basics, when you have an ion beam, a beam of IMEV ions, and interact with matter, then three are the main, we can categorize the interactions of the ion beam with the particles in three main categories. First of all, the most probable phenomena will cause ionizations inside the material along the ion trajectory. Then a little bit less probably is elastic scatterings on atomic electrons and the nuclei of the target of the material that the beam encounters. And the less probable interactions are nuclear reactions. On the right side of this presentation now, you can see 3 MeV proton beam that it is released on the air. One can see the trajectory of the ions and also how the ions spread in angular, the angular spreading of ions due to scattering. And also another thing is that we can see the beam, which is a result of luminescence of mostly nitrogen that it is on air. And this is a result of a secondary effect following the ionization of the air within this trajectory. These interactions actually we use for doing applications with ion beams, and main applications can be categorized in two basic categories, two big categories. One is one category of application is the materials characterization, so the beam can be used to study materials and characterize them, or to modify materials, and so we can do material modification. Regarding the characterization of materials, there are many techniques. The whole business is called ion beam analysis techniques. So depending on which material, on which product of the interactions of the beam with the target we detect. We can have, if we detect nuclear reaction products, that is charged particles, the technique is called nuclear reaction analysis. If products that we follow is gamma rays emitted also from nuclear reactions, we call, technique is called particle induced gamma ray emission. When we detect X-rays, the technique is called particle induced X-ray emissions. Accordingly, if we are following the, we are detecting the backscatter particles, we are speaking about the Rutherford backscattering RBS technique. And that if we're at the forward angle, the technique, and we're monitoring the recoil nuclei from the interaction of the, with the beam, we are speaking about the elastic recoil detection analysis, ERDA technique, or if we're at the, on the axis of the beam and we're following and we're monitoring the ion beam particles that are transmitted through the through our sample, then we're speaking about the steam technique. With all these techniques, we can get different information. First of all, with the PIXE technique, RBS ERDA technique, as well as with PGNN array, we can get elemental concentration information, and also we can determine the depth profile of the elements within the target. Depending on the technique, there are some advantages and disadvantages of the technique. So let's say for PGNN array, because there's monitoring reactions with specific isotopes of the elements of the target, then we're sensitive on isotopic information. When we're doing steam, as I will explain a little bit later, one observes variations in density of the material. Also, we will see in the following slides applications regarding the transport of the charge transport within semiconductors. And then we'll speak about the ion beam induced charge technique or current technique, which is called IBIC technique. And okay, we'll not speak about all the techniques, but the most common techniques that are applied is BICS, RBS, ERDA, NRA, STEAM, and PIC. When we're interested about modifying materials, one can use the ion beams either to implant, to inject some foreign atom inside the crystal or inside some target, or to displace some atom. And this is used in application of engineering of neutron vacancies, color centers, which are used for quantum applications. One can make quantum, one can make single ion tracks using fast heavy ions with energies of MeV per nucleon. And using this, one can create latent tracks of damage. And this is applied in nanostructuring applications. Other applications to modify materials regard the ion beam lithography. This is applied with protons, and the aim is to produce homogeneous radiation damage and produce very specified and localized defects, and then make engineering of defects. And one can use this to produce devices in micro, in nanoscale. So to do most of this application, one needs an ion microbeam. These microbeams can be focused in micrometer size or even sub-micrometer size. One of the best beams, which is in Singapore, can achieve 10 nanometer beam spot. Here in Ruđer Bošković, we have achieved up to 140 nanometers beam spot. In order to make imaging possible, this is done by controlling the positioning either of the beam or the sample. So by scanning the beam or the sample, we can obtain maps of either elements, or depending what the technique we're applying. One must have in mind that in order to focus a beam and have such a small beam, the initial ion beams that is produced by the accelerator must be first collimated. And as a result, the currents that are used in microbeams are limited more often up to a few nanoamperes. Therefore, for ion beam analysis applications, one should increase the solid angle and make better and measure have a better yield of the gamma ratio of the protons that he is measuring. So the detector should have a big solid angle, or so bigger than compared to what is being used in a conventional beam, not a microbeam. Moreover, with a microbeam and with the possibility of scanning and controlling the ions, one can use single ions and a focus beam of single ions. This is a very useful tool. A few of the applications that one can think with these tools is to induce charge in a specific and localized charge in detectors, in nanostructuring, as I showed you, to perform implantations and create color centers. So the advantages of working with a microbeam is that one can localize his study and also scan the beam and obtain maps and depth profiles. So, as I told you, starting from the left on this slide, initially the ion beam must be collimated, and then it is focused. And so, just to have an idea of when focusing some ion, so how difficult it is to focus an ion that is transversing through a magnetic field. This is obtained by the so-called magnetic rigidity of the beam, and it's given from this relation. And this is a measure of how difficult it is to bend a charged particle through a given radius in a magnetic field. So let's say to compare with electron microscopy, if you have 20 kV electrons and 2 MeV protons, the rigidity of the magnetic rigidity of 2 MeV protons is 400 times greater than 20 kV electrons. That has a result that, in contrast with electron microscopy, where solenoid lenses can be used to focus electrons, in MeV ions, this is not possible unless someone uses superconducting solenoids. So, in order to focus MeV ion beams, sets of quadrupole systems of magnetic or electrostatic quadrupoles are used. What defines the size of the beam spot size and how one can find this to communicate with people regarding the size of a microbeam, this is obtained by the magnification of the beam. So there, as we will see later, several configurations of quadrupoles have been taken into account throughout the years. So you need at least two sets of quadrupoles, because if you follow how the magnetic field is within one in each quadrupole, so one cannot focus both planes at the same time. So within the first quadrupole, one can focus, let's say, the horizontal plane, and passing through the second quadrupole can also, and focusing the horizontal plane, the vertical plane is defocused. So with a combination of two doublet or triplet quadrupoles, one can at the end achieve a focus in all planes. While focusing, there can be many possible sources of that influence the final microbeam spot size. Some of them I have noted here, which is of course the ion beam current. One should start with some decent ion beam current to collimate and then focus it. The beam spot is also affected by abbreviations of the focusing elements. One other important thing is the vibrations induced by either pumps or other components of our setup. Misalignments between these quadrupoles and the beam and the slits is also important, as well as working distances, and of course the levels of our vacuum in our chamber and also in the tubes in the beam line. Among the different quadrupole systems that have been studied, you can see here four of the most well-studied systems. In Ruđer Bošković, we are working with two systems, two setups. It is either we use a high energy excitation triplet configuration, which can give us the magnifications in X and Y up to 66. also, we use, depending on the rigidity of the ions, we use also a classical doublet configuration for high rigidity ions. And that is, we disconnect the first quadrupole. And we can do that by having different working distances for each configuration. So the working distance it is 11 centimeter for a triplet configuration and 26 centimeter for doublet configuration. You see on this sketch on the right the setup, how it looks from above. The three quadrupoles from that are positioned on the on a holder, which allows micrometer precision positioning of each quadrupole, as well as in X, Y, and Z, and as well as in tilt of each quadrupole, which is important to properly align each of these quadrupoles. And also we use a magnetic scanner to move this beam when it's focused. So starting from left to right in this figure, we have the beam while it comes from our accelerator. First, it meets the object slits. These slits need to be able to have a micrometer precision, and this in order to control the rate of the beam, as well as to fix the beam spot and be able to focus it even further. So these slits can be open in terms of hundreds of micrometers or even less in order to achieve good resolution. Following these object slits, then the beam is further collimated using collimated slits. Then the beam meets a beam chopper in our setup. This beam chopper aims to give us means to normalize the beam particle flux. So when someone does material analysis, he needs to have some means to know how many particles hit the target. So this chopper gives us this information. You can see in the picture here, it consists of one stepper motor, which moves and intercepts the beam by moving an aluminum sheet with a gold thin layer on top. And by measuring the backscattered particles from this sheet with a separate bar detector, one of them is this spectrum that you see on the bottom. And from this number, then from this from this spectrum and the integral of this peak, one can obtain the number of impinging particles. Anyways, after this chopper, the beam enters to the beam scanner. This is composed of two dipole magnets. There are ferrite cored deflector coils. We can scan, which are scanning the beam in X and Y dimensions, and they can give us a scanning distance up to 2 millimeters. And of course, they are controlled by the data acquisition system. And then the beam enters the quadrupole system, and finally enters the microprobe chamber. So the microprobe chamber on the top left here looks like this. It because, as we will see, a microbeam can be used for many different applications, not all kinds of ion beam analytical techniques and irradiations of materials. One needs to have many ports to be able to introduce many detectors. One first important thing is to have a viewport to be able to see the beam, because when focusing the beam, one needs to put to irradiate some scintillation material. So he needs to visually see the beam and adjust the size first on the scintillator. There is a load lock for easy loading the samples to be studied. One needs to have translators, motorized motor control translators, preferably to manipulate the beam X, Y, Z translation, as well as rotations. Going further inside the chamber in the bottom figure here, one can see the target holder in the middle, and the beam enters from above. And first, you can see a typical setup used for ion beam analytical purposes. So there is an annular surface barrier for rather backscattering. There is a silicon silicon detector for particle induced X-ray emission. As you see, all of these detectors are very close and they have relatively big solid angle, as I told you before. There's a detector for detecting nuclear reaction products. And also for forward angles, there is a possibility to rotate and put in on axis or off axis steam, a detector for doing steam analysis. On the right side, we see the similar setup that we have on the new microprobe. Here we can control the target position by a piezo stage manipulator. We have, as in the other microprobe, a pixel detector, an SDD this time pixel detector, and a surface bar detector that is used for rather for backscattering or for nuclear reaction analysis. Also, we have installed a germanium detector for big applications, and in forward angles, we have a steam detector that can be entered or in axis or off axis. In order to get the imaging with our study, and we need to scan our microbeam. So, as I told you, the beam enters from the object slits, and the scanning system, this magnetic scanning system, is controlled by the acquisition software, where the signal from the detector, the, let's say the X-ray detector, is also obtained, and one can monitor each peak of the X-rays or particles or whatever is applied, and correlate this with the beam position in our acquisition, and then a map can be produced from each of these peaks, from the integral of these peaks. And so one can get elemental maps, 2D elemental maps. One of the application that we did here in Ruđer Bošković concerned the application of NRA technique, PICS and RBS technique in the study, in microanalysis studies of dust particles that are produced in the operation of the jet tokamak. During the operation of the jet, dust is created from the interaction of the plasma with the materials of tokamak. And after the operation, dust collectors, as you see in this left bottom figure, which is a sticky carbon sticky pad, are collecting particles that are distributed within the volume of the different parts of the volume of the tokamak. These particles have these dimensions, as you see here, can be from 20 micrometers up to 200 micrometers, or even smaller to 10 micrometers. On the bottom figure, you see same images of these particles. IMB analytical techniques offer us here a very combined with a scanning microbeam, the nice possibility to be able to take all the information about all elements, from the lightest elements like deuterium to heaviest elements like tungsten. And this can be achieved by using a helium-3 beam. So with helium-3, we can probe light elements through nuclear reactions. So we collect spectra from an NRA detector of mostly proton particles that are emitted from helium-3 reactions on deuterium. So you see in this spectrum the peaks that one obtains from a surface bar detector due to these are protons emitted from different reactions. These protons, one should say that, as you see, there are at high energy part of our spectrum, which is background free, which results from the energy that the protons gain after the reaction due to the Q value of the nuclear reactions. And so with NRA, we can obtain deuterium, beryllium, carbon, boron, and other elements if present, light elements. Combined this technique and array in parallel with PICS and RBS, as I told you, we can obtain elemental information about heavier elements. With pixel, you can measure aluminum, nickel, chromium, iron, and even heavier elements. This synergy, with this synergy, we're able to obtain not only the map, but also quantitative, to do quantitative analysis, so we can obtain the absolute concentration depth profiles of all these elements that you see here with micrometer resolution. And then one can associate, can find correlations and associate each particle, each element, can make correlations with between elements. So one can understand from and make decisions about the corrosion of or the how the walls of the tokamak are affected by during its operation. Another nice application of our of the microbeam is the imaging of the elemental imaging of sensitive samples. Because these all techniques, these ion beam analytical techniques, they have one nice characteristic that they are least destructive or non-destructive. So the samples after the measurement can be reused. And of course, when one studies cultural heritage object, you should apply one non-destructive technique. Here we see one application that we did here in Ruđer Bošković using one painting. And where the aim was to study the analysis, to do an analysis of the pigment layers and find do a 2D elemental distribution of pigment along the cross section of a sample taken from different areas of the one painting. And here you see the elemental maps of this of the sample. And from this one, this is used in studying either the authenticity of paintings to see and compare the concentration and the elemental profile of these pigments to databases that exist, or even take measures to see if there is any corrosion, or take measures to protect these artifacts. Except elemental imaging, a few other examples I have noted here. It's regarding steam imaging. As I told you, this is scanning transmission ion microscopy. In this situation, for this measurement, one needs to have first of all a thin sample, so the beam can exit the sample, can cross the whole sample, and it's not does not stop inside the sample. So in this case, after the target surface barrier or a silicon diet can be, or anyway, a particle detector can be positioned with a relatively good resolution on the axis of the beam. And what is being measured there, it is the energy loss of the particles after they transverse the target. And this energy loss is related to the thickness or the density of the target. This way one can obtain density maps. You see in the middle the density maps of a wing of a fly that we measured here in our laboratory. This we did with 6 MeV oxygen ions. Another applications of this is in the study of human tissues, or here in the right picture you can see the microscope image and overlaid with the colored image is the steam image of a human muscle tissue affected by neuromuscular diseases. This we did with 2 MeV protons. And one can observe the nice pictures that one can get with using steam microscopy. Apart from elemental or density maps or structure maps, let's say, one can have the option of obtaining molecular images. This is done using the MeV SIMS technique. SIMS stands for secondary ion mass spectrometry. So you see the interior here of our microbeam. First of all, to do that in SIMS, we use some heavy ion beam, and that is, and we need at least to have energies of 1 MeV per nucleon. This way, we can the beam, when it interacts with the target, it sputters molecules or ions or atoms from the surface of the materials. So these ions, initially the sputtered ions, have a very small energy and they kind of float above the target. So one needs to put an extractor to attract this some voltage to attract these sputtered ions. So this is what this pointy thing close to the target holder is in this picture. This is an extractor that sucks these secondary ions, which they then travel within a flight path, and they meet and they terminate and they are detected at a microchannel plate detector. So if someone has means to have a start and this and use this detection of ions as a stop, then he can determine the time needed for this for each secondary ion to travel this flight path with from the extractor to the detector. And with this way, one can measure the mass of the one can do mass spectroscopy of the products of secondary ions. So this start signal, this trigger, is obtained for thick targets using a beam chopper connected to and controlled in parallel with measurement from the acquisition system. And in the case of thin targets, that is, a beam can transverse through the target, the start signal can be obtained with a steam detector with position after the target, as in the case of the steam imaging. So in parallel, one can do, of course, several techniques, like both techniques, if it is in the case of a thin sample, like in the case that I show in the right picture of this slide. So one can apply both steam and SIMS techniques and get both at the same time the density maps as well as molecular masses and molecular maps. So here in this picture, you see a study that was done with 9 MeV oxygen beam, having a total scan size of 85 micrometers. And this study concerned the study of cells from human adenocarcinoma. And you can see here the nice maps that you can update. First of all, here the colored image from steam, the density maps, as well as maps from lipid molecules. And these are combined with optical images. And with this way, one can get molecular maps. However, one needs to mention here regarding this SIMS technique is that typically the mass spectra that one obtains are very rich, and the identification of its ion, of each of these secondary produced ions, it's not very straightforward. It is still under research. Apart from studying elemental studies of materials, an ion microprobe can be used to study semiconductor devices or other detector devices, and using a technique that it is called ion beam induced charge. In this situation, for this case, the target that we shoot with a beam is the detector itself. So in contrast with the previous techniques that I mentioned in this presentation, This is a technique that it is, let's say, low current technique. So because the beam is shot directly on the detector. So typically the currents used in IBIC studies and are maximum of the order of femtoamperes. While for ion beam analytical techniques, useful currents are up to nanoamperes. So in this case, as I told you, the beam is focused on the sample, and the sample is our detector, so it is connected to some charge-sensitive preamplifier and an amplifier. And as such, the voltage or the signal, anyways, which is proportional to the charge that it is creating the signal inside the detector, is being monitored parallel in phase with a scanning. With a scanning system, and as such, images of charged transport can be obtained. The sample can be irradiated either by frontal orientation or a lateral orientation, and as such, the techniques are having special variations like frontal IBIC or lateral IBIC. So in this, the current which is induced by the electrons, the current is induced in the electrodes of the detector by the motion of the charge carriers inside the volume, the sensitive volume of our detection system. And the measurement, the final signal depends on the electric field inside the device, and as well as the mobilities and the movement of the charge carriers inside the sensitive volume of our detector. So in frontal IBIC, you can see here one can obtain this charge transport along the surface of the detector. Depending on the beam energy, one can probe different depths on this study, and one can obtain these maps of charge collection efficiency, as it is called, and in the case that the study is focused on the lateral IBIC, one can see how charge is collected and how electrons or holes, which is typically the charge carriers, are how is the diffusion length and how they are collected at different positions or different areas of the sensitive volume of the detector. More in the other variation of IBIC technique, one can change the angle of incidence typically by moving actually the target, not the ions, which have a specific axis. And with this kind of studies, by rotating the target, one can make studies of, let's say, like the dead layer of our detector, or probe different depths without changing the beam energy. Another variation of IBIC is what is called the time result IBIC. So in this situation, in parallel with the IBIC map, one can connect a fast broadband preamplifier directly to a digital oscilloscope. And this way, one can study the transient current or charge pulses during irradiation. Examples that recently we did here in Ruđer Bošković are following in the next slides. So one study concept the characterization of 3D detectors, detectors with designed with 3D contact device, with 3D contacts. And with the IBIC technique, one can obtain very detailed information regarding the charge collection efficiency within the whole volume of the detector, between the strips or at close to the contacts or further to the contacts, and that's this way design take decisions regarding the design of the detector and monitor how efficiently it behaves within its whole volume. Another application concerned not detection of particles, but application of power electronics. So the study here was to, the aim here was to study how charge is collected from silicon power diodes. For this study, we had this power diode, this silicon diode that you can see on the right small figure. And using an IPIC based technique, one can make a protocol of how to, or experimental methodology, let's say, of how to study this device by changing the ion beam, by obtaining IPIC images at different energies, so that means different depths, by changing the depletion layer by that is obtained by varying the applied voltage, and also by even fine-tuning the probing depth by varying the angle of incidence. Another study that one can do with ion beam induced with IPIC technique is a study of radiation hardness of devices. Let's say in this picture you see an application on diamond detectors where one can use initially two beams. First, focus some beam in aiming to create radiation induced defects, so to somehow create defects inside the crystal, and then probe defects, these areas, by studying the charge transport around these areas with IBIC, where one expects that these defects will reduce the lifetime of the charge carriers within the volume, and one expects the charge collection efficiency to be smaller. So one can use this to study these effects and monitor how radiation hardened are different devices and how they respond to different radiations. Another study of one more study of the IBIC is to that we think using different energies we can probe different depths and make an imaging of the electric field of various detectors that are various micro machine detectors. So one can study in 3D the electric fields, both in lateral scanning, but also in depth by varying the energy of the beam and achieving deeper information. Before I close, I show you here some of our future activities, or I mean, what we aim in the future with a new microprobe. So one can have one microbeam, but it is better to have two microbeams maybe on your target. And here you see our currently under development new microprobe. So far we have achieved nice microbeams from our 1 megavolt tandetron accelerator. We have managed to focus the beam down to 250 nanometers. And we have here the option to have two working distances for each accelerator. So we have the long focus and the short focus. And this will give us a unique opportunity to have two microbeams from one accelerator, from two accelerators in one area. This already we have developed, as I told you, one microbeam, and we are currently under the developing of the microbeam from the big action, from the Van de Graaff accelerator. However, we can have done so far studies with a collimated beam from the big accelerator and the microbeam from the small accelerator in situ irradiations and IBIC probing using pulse and dual ion microbeams. For this, we used it to demonstrate the feasibility of these studies. We used in silicon diode, where we first collimated a beam from our Van de Graaff accelerator, a beam of 8 MeV carbon ions, which was a damaging, which we aim to induce radiation damage. And from the small accelerator, we could study the charge transport properties after the radiation damage by using IBIC technique. Well, pretty much that was it regarding microprobe techniques. Thank you very much. I hope it was not too much for Friday afternoon. I think that there is a video that can be displayed regarding this technique.
Yes, exactly. I will share my screen right now in few
okay.
seconds.
I stop sharing. I don't know regarding questions if we are doing, if the people have now or we do after the presentation. That is up to you. I don't know.
Let's see if there are any questions for now in the chat. I don't see any questions, but if you prefer, we can go through them after. Maybe.
Okay, let's see the videos, and if anyone has questions, I will be available. Okay, I stop sharing now.
Please let me know if you can see my screen and hear the video.
Yes.
Okay.
Hello, this is my colleague Andrea, that's Marco. I am Matea, and today we will talk about the nuclear microprobe applications. The main task of today's experiment is to demonstrate how the ion beam analysis techniques can also be used as a powerful tool in microscopic imaging. This means that in addition to providing the information of elemental composition and concentrations, we can also see how these elements are distributed on a microscopic level. So for the successful demonstration, we need samples that have inhomogeneous distribution of elements on the surface, for which we have prepared cross sections of dried human cell tissue cells that are used in biological studies, and the sample of cross section of pigments used in cultural heritage applications. Before the measurement, we need to mount the samples onto a universal sample holder and load it in the scattering chamber. But to do that, we need to first mount it in the load lock pre-chamber. Within the scattering chamber, we have several detectors. And for this experiment, the most important one is the X-ray detector for pixie measurement, which is positioned in a backward angle at 45 degrees.
The main prerequisite to perform an ion beam microscopy measurement is to focus an ion beam into a small microscopic spot on the position where the sample is situated. For this, we need an apparatus that is often called a nuclear microprobe, which can focus ions into a desired spatial spot and thus enable the application of ion beam as a microscope. The heart of such a system is a focusing lens, which has the same principle of operation as the converging optical lens. Optical lens has to focus sunlight into a very small spot. And then we can use this spot to burn the paper. In the case of fast ions of MeV energy range, we have to use magnetic forces to bend the ion trajectory. More specifically, we use quadrupole magnetic fields. And after the beam passes through a single quadrupole, the Lorentz forces will bend the ions into a single plane, horizontal or vertical. Therefore, we need to couple several of quadrupole magnets to achieve focusing of the ion beam in a single point in space. For this, we use triplet of quadrupoles. In addition to focusing action, we also need scanning capabilities to be able to move the beam around the sample surface. In our case, we use two electromagnetic dipoles that can steer the beam in the horizontal or vertical direction. The first step in the microprobe experiment is the focusing of the beam. To enable precise focusing with quadrupole magnetic fields, incoming ions have to travel along a well-defined trajectory. After we pass the beam into the chamber, we have to focus the beam by changing the currents in the quadrupoles and subsequently changing their magnetic fields. With the triplet system, focusing is rather simple, as we can almost independently focus the horizontal and vertical dimensions. After the beam is focused, we can turn on the scanning coils, which are controlled by the data acquisition system. The scanning size can be easily changed, and therefore different size sample areas can be investigated.
The first sample we will analyze today is a human tissue cross-section sample. Here on the right-hand side, you can see the sample that has already been mounted in the scattering chamber. And by the use of a long working distance microscope, we may position the sample in the region of interest that we would like to map. So first, we will collect the pixie spectrum of the sample region. For each event in the spectrum, which is collected here, we record its energy and the XY position. So in this particular sample, we can see that the following elements are present. Sodium, silicon, which is actually the backing of the sample, phosphorus, chlorine, sulfur, and potassium. So the regions of interest, these regions of interest that correspond to these elements, set for every detected X-ray, have their own spatial distributions, so within this scanned area. And this way, we can image the spatial distributions of each element in the sample. And here you can see elemental distribution for sodium, for silicon, phosphorus, sulfur, potassium, chlorine. Here is our second example of painting cross-section of a pigment from a painted fresco in the 16th century church in Istria. Here again on the right-hand side, we can see the microscopic picture of the pigment sample that we have measured. And on the left-hand side, we can see the total pixie spectrum we have collected. In this particular sample, the following elements are present: aluminium, silicon, sulfur, potassium, calcium, iron, and lead. And this is the distribution of each of the four elements that I have already mentioned in the sample. So lead is distributed here, potassium, calcium, aluminium, silicon, iron, and again, lead.
In previously shown experiment, we have used a proto microbeam with a beam current of 100 picoamperes, but there are also several characterization techniques that utilize very low currents in order of 1 femtoampere or even below that. That corresponds to less than 6,000 ions per second in the case of proton beam. One of these low current techniques is STIM, scanning transmission ion microscopy. In our case, silicon detector placed just behind the sample is used to measure the energy loss of every single ion that has been transmitted through the sample. If we use heavy ion microbeam instead of conventional proton beam, for example, if we expose the sample to 10 MeV silicon ions, a significantly higher ionization and energy deposition will result in huge increase in the emission of secondary particles from the surface layers of the sample. A vast majority of these particles are neutral, but some of them are ionized, and we can detect them using suitable mass spectrometer.
In our system, mass spectrometer is located just above the microprobe entrance tube. Obtained energy loss distribution can be used to determine distribution of sample thickness. Here is a steam map of some organic sample. This can be a very useful information when doing elemental imaging by PIXI. Secondary ions are accelerated from the sample toward spectrometer by static electric field. After traveling through the field-free region of the spectrometer, they are detected using microchannel plate detector, which also records the arrival time of each of these ions. This technique is called MEV SIMS. SIMS stands for secondary ion mass spectrometry. The MEV SIMS spectrum is much more complex than PIXI spectrum. It shows distribution of time of flights of detected ions, which can then be transferred to mass distribution. The first peak spectrum is hydrogen with mass 1. Then we have a bunch of different peaks with masses up to 100. But the most interesting region for MEV SIMS are peaks in the range with masses from 100 to 1000, where many organic molecules and their fragments can be found. Therefore, we can clearly say that MEV SIMS that is used for molecular analysis is a very complementary technique to PIXI used for elemental analysis.
Low current ion beams can be used for quite a different application. To test radiation detectors by means of spatial mapping of their response to energetic ions. This technique is called IBIC, ion beam induced charge technique, and is based on imaging of the ratio between measured and induced charge in the detector, the so-called charge collection efficiency. On the screen, we can see one example of an IBIC map, where the detector in question was exposed to radiation damage by high-dose ion irradiation in these selected rectangular regions. We monitored degradation of the detector's response and used this data to characterize the radiation hardness and other parameters of the device. Specifically, the investigated radiation detector was constructed using high-quality synthetic diamond. Diamond-based devices are a developing area of semiconductor radiation detectors and are finding their use in a number of new applications. In this video, we have shown you the applications of nuclear microprobe. Thank you for watching.